The title, Robots Living Amongst Us, sounds rather like science fiction, not fact. And tonight we'll be exploring just how close we are to this science fiction scenario. How much is hype, and how much is real hardware? In 2011, Foxconn announced plans to deploy more than 1 million robots in their manufacturing plants by the year 2014. Now, that's almost as many robots as Foxconn's human workers. And it would also double the number of industrial robots deployed in the world, which would seriously skew the projected growth rates for industrial robots. So most people said, that's hype. But the robot news just keeps coming, like Amazon's acquisition of Kiva Systems for a hefty $775 million in early 2012, and the Google acquisitions since then. We've seen increasing investment in robotics and the insertion of hardware into the startup world of accelerators and funds. In 2012, the first two hardware accelerators opened, Hexcelerator and Lemnos Labs. The first fund for robotics was also announced by both Grishin Robotics and Robolution Capital in France. However, Rodney Brooks was well ahead of the times, as always. He actually launched Robotic Ventures in the year 2000, and while the company is now folded, they did invest in companies like Mako Surgical. 2013 saw six more robotics and hardware accelerators open. The walls of the software world are crumbling. Paul Graham from Y Combinator, the most famous of software accelerators, publicly declared the hardware renaissance was here. And already in 2014, another 9 or 10 robotics and hardware accelerators have opened, with more in the pipelines. But mainly, I really just wanted to have a hockey stick growth curve for robotics. At the other end of the scale, 2014 also saw the launch of RoboStocks, the first robotics stock index and ETF, or exchange-traded fund, which is trading 77 publicly listed robotics companies, companies with market values between $200 million and $125 billion. That's a median value of $2 to $3 billion per company. It sounds great, but it's misleading. Those wealthy companies are industrial conglomerates like ABB and Foxconn, like Bosch and Boeing. They do more than what we consider to be robotics. But venture investment in early stage robotics companies is on the rise. These figures from 2011-2012 from Hazook show the sometimes unexpected places that investment is happening. Companies we may not have heard of or even considered as robotics companies. Primarily in health, but also strong growth in agriculture. The corrections factor in a couple of missed companies and some additional funding rounds for the companies already listed. I also recommend you visit the International Federation of Robotics, or IFR, for more information, particularly across all of the sectors: industrial, professional, professional service robotics, and personal service robotics. Industrial robotics is still the dominant paradigm. There are 1.5 million industrial robots deployed globally with a market value of around $30 billion. Foxconn notwithstanding, the market is comparatively saturated. The real growth area will be in professional service robotics, where high unit cost combines with high projected growth. Professional service robots include surgical, health, farming, and logistics robots. Personal robots, on the other hand, are domestic appliances. They're educational and toy robots, and they typically sell for only a few hundred dollars. For consumer robots to meet the same potential market value as professional service robots, we're talking billions of units. But what is the most popular robot in the world today? Yes, iRobot has shipped more than 10 million household robots, making the Roomba the most widely deployed robot in the world. And what will our next household robot be? What sector of robotics will see the most potential for growth in? These are some of the questions for our panel. Please text your question to 650-308, read, don't listen, 8522. I'm really looking forward to a great discussion because we have a fantastic panel. We have Melanie Wise, the CEO and founder of Unbounded Robotics. We have Milan Shah, the VP of Software for Rethink Robotics. We have John Dulcinos, the VP of Global Automation for JBL. And we have Peter Hebert, the co-founder of Lux Capital, with investments in the robotics space particularly. Not only do we have a fantastic panel, but I'm wondering if maybe roboticists have been getting it wrong. For too long, robotics has been a technology without a cause, over-promising and under-delivering. Perhaps we've been building robots, not services. Kiva Systems removed the robot from their marketing altogether. They focused on the magic. What if they just make it work? The robots are merely the delivery mechanism. In 2006, South Korea announced the grand vision of a robot in every home by the year 2020. We all pictured a humanoid. Perhaps the best robots don't need to be called robots because they just do what we need. They're invisible appliances. In fact, by the year 2020, I predict that your next household robot will be your house. Not humanoid robots promised by science fiction, or for that matter by South Korea. We live in interesting times. We're surrounded by robots we don't see, while we're still waiting for the robots we imagine. Perhaps we should also be looking further afield at the new collaborative robots that we're going to hear more about today. Robots that offer the potential to transform manufacturing and the professional service robotics sector. Robots that can work with humans. Collaborative robots that may eventually evolve into the personal household robot. Who knows? Collaborative robots can work safely with humans outside of safety enclosures for all or part of their operations, both industrial and non-industrial. Standards are having a hard time keeping up because some of the potential use cases haven't happened yet. These devices and the situations that we'll find them in are still comparatively unknown. To date, there are standards or drafts for 5 human-robot workplaces, with 4 methods of operating safely within a collaborative workspace for the protection of humans. Robots in a collaborative scenario must satisfy at least 1 criteria to meet the standard: a safety-rated monitored stop, hand guiding, speed and separation monitoring, or power and force limiting. Now, that's good as far as it goes, but the technology is outpacing the standards and the business use cases are only just emerging. As well as asking what are the potential collaborative workspaces, we should also be asking, who are all the potential collaborators? The fastest growing sector of the robotics market is the milking machine. Cows are the queens of the quantified self movement. We now have fully automated dairy farms where it's quite possible for cows to milk and feed themselves 24/7. Farms are a long way from our urban existence, so few of us are aware of the way in which these robots are transforming the way we think of work. They're even transforming the human-machine interface. Increasingly, humans are out of the loop or being told what to do by machines. At a robotic dairy farm, it's possible for cows to be moved from pasture to pasture, from pasture to milking, from milking to food, even to back scratches, all without human intervention. Along the way, an incredible amount of data is being compiled, and individual cows can be isolated or given extra supplements. And all this information goes directly to the farmer's computer, all without human intervention. Farming used to be a science of averages, and now it's truly becoming precision agriculture. Most importantly, cows like it. Cows on robot dairy farms are happy cows, with higher milk yields, fewer illnesses, and lower stress levels. Now, a system like the Lely astronaut milking system or the intuitive surgical system works with humans and with cows. It is safe, it is compliant, but I would argue that it's a compliant robot rather than a fully collaborative robot. What we're going to hear about tonight is are fully collaborative robots that are capable of meeting a range of work tasks and scenarios and are able to be reconfigured. Our next speaker, Melanie Wise, CEO and founder of Unbounded Robotics, calls their Uber One a capability platform. And a capability platform really describes the true potential of these new reconfigurable collaborative robots. Over to you, Melanie.
Thank you, Andra. So I'm Melanie. I'm the CEO of Unbounded Robotics. And tonight I'm going to tell you a little bit about our company. But before I start that, I wanted to tell you a little bit about the history of our company because it's so important in kind of framing how we got to where we are today. So Unbounded Robotics is a spin-off of Willow Garage, and actually tonight we have the former CEO of Willow Garage, Steve Cousins, in the audience, and it's a real credit to him that all of this came from Willow Garage. Willow Garage was a powerhouse for robotics over the course of about six and a half years. In that time, it produced four commercial spin-outs, three open source organizations, and a cluster of open source products. All of these products and companies have really been bulkheads pushing forward into new frontiers in robotics. The Open Source Robotics Foundation, even today, shepherds ROS, the Open Source Robotics Operating System, that many robotics companies and research organizations use today. And I'm just going to show you some videos from Willow Garage and kind of the accomplishments that came out of it. So Willow Garage was founded to create and accelerate the robotics industry. And the path to doing that in the mind of Willow Garage was to do it by creating two things: an open source operating system that allowed robotics researchers and different robotics organizations to collaborate, share code, and to bring all of that knowledge together in one place. The other aspect of it was to create a platform that enabled robotics researchers to get all on the same page. The problem, you know, before the PR2, which is in the top there, with robotics research is that everyone had their own robot and everyone kept starting over from the beginning to create their own robot. And it was very intensive and it caused a lot of delay. And then once you had your own robot and you did research with that robot, you couldn't share it with anyone because no one else had your robot. So by creating the PR2 and marrying it with ROS, you opened the door to massive amounts of collaboration and made it possible for the transition of this research into products and into the commercial space, which is what we really wanted to see. Now, one of the things that you may be asking yourself, well, you know, if Willow Garage was this great powerhouse, well, where are the commercial products that came out of it? Well, you know, in the same way that we started with the Model T of cars, you don't suddenly, you know, 5 years later, get a Toyota Corolla. I hate to break it to you. And so Willow Garage set the foundation for robots like this to come into our daily lives. But the thing that a lot of robotics companies struggle with, especially startups, is specifically finding a real-world problem, designing a robot for that problem, and then putting robots into the real world. And so here's my buddy, UBR1, he's coming over here. And so here's our robot in the real world. So UBR1 is a mobile manipulation platform. UBR1 has a pan tilt head so he can see the world, or I guess he's not a he, he's a robot. It has a 7 degree of freedom arm, so the arm is completely back drivable and compliant. It's also gravity compensated, which that means is that when I put the arm there, it doesn't fall down, it doesn't crash into the floor, it stays where it's supposed to be. One of the things that we've added for safety is that when you hit the run stop, because you don't want robots to take over the world, the arm falls gently to the ground and it doesn't come crashing down, hurting anyone or itself. But then you easily release the run stop and go back on your way. So in addition to that, the UBR1 can get taller. And so this allows the UBR1 to work in human scale environments. Human scale environments is a key to being able to do things in the real world, to solve real problems and have real robots in the real world. By being able to work at human scale, to do human scale tasks, we can have autonomous agents in our world doing work for us and helping us in our daily lives. Well, thank you very much, UBR1. I'm going to continue on now. So UBR1 has many capabilities. Like Andra said, this is a capability platform. The UBR1 has a capability to navigate in complex environments. It can see very complex items like that shelf. It's metal, it's shiny, it doesn't have much context to it, and the robot can easily navigate around it, see the object, and continue going. In addition to that, UBR1 has a capability to do other capabilities like calibrate itself. We have several different forms of calibration, and this is one where it takes a couple minutes, it looks at its checkerboard, and it recognizes, you know, how out of calibration it is or not. And so this is just another capability. But then you can combine that capability into much more complex tasks like this, doing completely autonomous chess playing. The robot is detecting the chess pieces, identifying where they are, responding to a player moving, grabbing the chess pieces, and this is all autonomous. The robot isn't being puppeted like it just was now. It's doing all of this behavior autonomously. And so when you look at all of these things, you know, the next question is, so you have a robot in the real world, but I started this all by saying you actually need to solve a real world problem. And so today, this is our real world problem. There's about 15,000 warehouses in the United States that do order fulfillment and e-commerce. Of those 15,000 warehouses, approximately 60 to 80% of them do it using paper-based picking. A person goes to a printer and picks a piece of paper off of a printer and then reads the instruction and goes line by line walking through a warehouse to pick it off the shelf. It's very error prone. They see error rates of 10% in some cases. And that is a big burden on a business. And so by bringing a robot into the scene, you can reduce some of that error because the robot doesn't need to walk through the aisles and look at the shelf numbers and figure it out. We have a map of the environment. We know exactly where to go. And you may be asking yourself, well, warehouses have tens of thousands of items. Like, how could the robot ever recognize all of those things? Well, some of the secret sauce to doing that is it's not about recognizing the individual objects. It's about segmenting the individual objects out. So in the pictures I have here, we have a shelf full of objects. And then we have the image view of the robot looking at those objects. And then the next step is that we segment those objects into individual parts. And after we segment those objects into individual parts, we then identify them as unique objects that are graspable. It's not about identifying the unique object, it's about grabbing the object that we need to grab. And then once we have that object in our hand, we detect whether it's valid or not, which is a much simpler problem than trying to go and find the box of Cheerios in 10,000 items. You actually know where the box of Cheerios is, you go and grab it, and then you verify that it's the box of Cheerios. And so what does this look like for a robot to do this? So the robot drives over to its shelf. And this is an early demo, guys. It goes, it sees the object, and all of this is autonomous. So the robot navigated over to the shelf, it identified the object, pulled it out of the box, and you can tell that this is autonomous because the arm does some fancy arm planning. Normally, you know, if we had scripted it, it wouldn't have looked as creative as that. So I wanted to make my talk brief so we could get on to the panel discussion, but that's kind of our vision for how robots will play in the real world and the problem that we're tackling today. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Melanie. On that note, your vision for the future, Milange, would you share a little bit about Rethink's vision for the future?
Sure, Andrea. Thank you for having me here. So Rethink Robotics has a famous sort of history as well. It was founded by a gentleman named Rod Brooks. Some of you might know him. He was also the founder of iRobot. But much more importantly, in many, many, many ways, he sort of started this generation of robotic technology back in 84, 85, here at Stanford, when he apparently was helping a grad student with a robot PhD thesis, and you know it was supposed to navigate through a maze of some kind. The maze was designed to be navigable, big blocks with high contrast paints on it, and so on and so forth. Apparently, this robot would survey the situation, move a few feet, then have to stop while the mainframe re-surveys the situation and move again, right? And it would move maybe a meter in 15 minutes type of thing, yeah? And of course, the thesis was at 4 in the afternoon. They perfected it at 2 in the afternoon. At 4, everything stops working because the shadows moved, yeah? And that caused Mr. Brooks to sort of ask himself the question, so something is fundamentally wrong here, yeah? We have a mainframe computing this movement. How is it that, you know, an insect can perfect a six-legged gait but this movement is, this mainframe is not able to move this robot more than 15 meters, or 15, a meter every 15 minutes. And he asked himself a fundamental question, right? And which is, to me, it's absolutely amazing, which is what if there is no such thing as intelligence? That's why it's so hard to build artificial intelligence, because we're trying to build something that doesn't exist. What if in reality, all it is sensors and actuators with very simple logic in there, yeah? We all know at some level, examples, neurons, for example, right? They transmit very slowly, they don't have much computing power, yet when I touch a hot thing, my finger will recoil instantly. It's easy to show that that signal really didn't travel to my brain, which did some amazing intelligent thing and recoiled my hand. Instead, the sensors in my hand instructed the muscles in my hand to recoil, right? So that brings us to rethink. So basically, he, over 30 years, perfected what is called behavior robotics, which is the basic idea of taking sensors and connecting them to actuators and building layers of intelligence such that the higher level intelligence can subsume the lower level intelligence. And when you do that, he has showed through many different robotic implementations that intelligence, what you and I would consider as intelligence, seems to emerge. So now you're in 2014, what's happening? Because of mobile devices, sensors are incredibly cheap. They are less than a cent a piece, right? Accelerometers, proximity sensors, cameras, all kinds of sensors because of the sort of the mobile movement have become incredibly cheap. And that's what allows us to build something like Baxter, which is Rethink Robotics' humanoid robot. It can be programmed to become more and more and more intelligent. It knows how to avoid colliding with things as it's doing its task in the factory, for example, or dropping its hand on the floor when sort of the power goes off. It can be programmed to do many things that together appear to be intelligent. The other big sort of innovation that fed into Rethink was this idea, as Andrea mentioned, of a compliant robot, a robot that is actually safe to operate next to a human. And the reason for that is the fundamental innovation is essentially a spring element between the motor and the joints that are moving that allows the arm to actually have some amount of flexibility or compliance. So if it hits you, the spring actually recoils and as opposed to absorbs the force of the impact, thus making it very safe to operate in a human context. But more importantly, this spring also allows us to measure forces and very, very small amounts of forces, very much like how humans measure forces when they're manipulating things. And that the combination of behavior robotics and this incredibly fine force sensing allows us to build robots which are now collaborative. They can work next to human beings. They can do many of the tasks, that mundane tasks, like packing boxes, feeding machines, that kind of stuff that humans today do, yeah? And we are suddenly seeing a whole new wave of applications of robotics, yeah? So that's what Rethink Robotics is all about. I've been there myself only about a couple of months. I come from more of a traditional software background. And our goal is to launch or make Baxter into hopefully the next sort of PC revolution, provide everybody with essentially a programming or application platform where you can use your imagination to program our robots to do things that, of course, I haven't imagined yet, yeah? So very exciting times, and glad to be here.
Thanks, Milan. Now, John, you've got a very interesting background as well as your current, and I'd be very interested in your future thoughts on robotics now. So would you give us a quick introduction?
Sure. I think it's going to be hard to top what Milan did, so I'll be a little shorter. I work for Jabil, which is the probably the largest or the largest company you've never heard of. We're a $20 billion contract manufacturer that builds, you know, we're the brand behind the brands. We build, you know, all the cool mobile phones and consumer electronics devices and power meters and all of those things. And so I guess first and foremost, let me just say that we're based out in San Jose and we're hiring like crazy. So if anybody's looking for a job, I'm sure we have some spots for you. Before my job at Jabil is to lead their global automation strategy. You know, I think one of the things about contract manufacturers over the last 30, 40 years is they've been just chasing lower and lower cost labor markets to build their products. And you know, I think the exciting thing is I think we're at this cusp now where that trend can shift and come back. And you know, my role is to help the company build a model that allows us to build products anywhere in the world at the same cost point. Prior to Jabil, I worked at Adept. I was the CEO of Adept Technology, that was the kind of one of the elder statesmen in the industrial robotics market, founded back in 1983. And I guess there's we sold robots into the industrial market. And there's a saying in the pet food industry that you have to eat your own pet food. So I spent all these years selling robots to manufacturers to automate their factories. Now I went to become a manufacturer. Now I have to actually put them in and make them work. So I guess I'm learning the hard way. But I'm happy to be here. I think it's a great time in robotics. I started my career in 1984 because I read an article in IEEE magazine that said that the personal robot revolution was about to occur and it was going to be bigger than the PC industry. So here I am now 30 years later, and I think we're getting close to it starting. So happy to be back at the beginning of my career again. So
thanks, John. That's... Peter, you're the rogue venture capitalist in the bunch of roboticists. Oh, yeah. You're kind of like the dog food for them.
Hopefully not. So, I can give you background to myself and certainly what we do at Lux. So I'm one of the founders of the firm. We started in 2000. And our focus, this is Lux Capital, is really emerging technology companies, but really based upon and predicated on science and hard technology. So that brings us into a lot of areas, not the least of which is robotics. So we're heavy investors in robotics, and we can talk about some of the trends that we're seeing, how we're investing, which we believe hopefully is nuanced and has a wise strategy behind it, but also a number of other areas that are somewhat related that we see a great amount of overlap that actually informs our strategy. And so that includes things like 3D printing, 3D scanning, a number of other things in UAVs, satellites, and then also in the medical space and some medical devices. So, you know, I think I was asked to really talk about why we think robotics is an interesting area right now, and specifically where we're focused on and why. So I do think that there are a range of technologies, as previously mentioned, not just robotics, core robotics technologies emerging from labs like Stanford or CMU, but also related trends and drivers that are increasingly making robotic technologies applicable to industries that never would have considered it. And it's not about direct labor replacement in many cases, but really creating capabilities that otherwise wouldn't have existed. And a lot of that is driven by consumer electronics and the smartphone revolution, where you have very sophisticated compute and sensor platforms that are now driven into mobile and handheld applications, which allow robotics to take advantage of it. So as we really crafted an investment strategy around robotics, it was not just robotics for robotics' sake. There are a lot of really interesting, cool technologies and companies, especially around this area, that we consistently see. But we found, historically and even today, it's really difficult as an investor to get paid for the amount of risk that you're taking, and certainly for the journey and the amount of capital that's required. It is hard, and we're certainly in an area where people are seeing a lot of zeros being thrown around for things that could have been founded 12 or 18 months prior. This is just not one of those types of areas, unfortunately. And so we've found that we have to dig up our, roll up our sleeves and dig in and really identify areas and applications that there is a high value placed by the markets, not just businesses and customers that will ultimately serve to provide those initial dollars, but that the market recognizes something as a differentiated company and will pay for that. So if you look at, you know, in kind of advance of this panel, I was just looking at the public companies that are involved in robotics and that are not these massive conglomerates that have some, you know, very small portion of their business affiliated with robotics. And realistically, there's been, I think, a grand total of three companies in the past 20 years, venture-backed companies, that have achieved a market capitalization of greater than $1 billion. two specifically in the medical field, one Intuitive Surgical, the other Mako Surgical, acquired about 9 months ago by Stryker for $1.65 billion. And then the other one that a lot of people know, and Rod Brooks and Helen Greiner, who we're proud to back in our fund, were co-founders of, which is iRobot. And it's not for lack of a lot of ventures trying to reach those large markets and access them. But really, besides those three, there is Kiva and Amazon. And after that, it's a very steep drop-off. And that's something that we're just cognizant of and constantly screen for, that despite how sexy and interesting and charismatic an entrepreneur can be or a company can seem, we just need to make sure that, unfortunately, are these applications, are these products, are these companies that we can actually make money and deliver profits back to our limited partners?
Thanks, Peter. That's, I think that's food for thought for a lot of us, and it just has me wondering, everyone else on the panel is bound to have a story about how hard it was trying to get funded based on that. John, do you have one to share with us?
Well, I think that, when we were, when I was running Adept, we went out and bought a mobile robot company, very small little research organization, and we wanted to commercialize the product from researchers into industrial applications. And we went on the road for about a year, telling the story, talking about the applications, the markets, our technology, our ideas, and we were an established company, but no one wanted to take the risk. They wanted to come back when you had a product and you had customers and you had proof statements and almost you were going downhill so that someone could give you money. And I think that it took us over a year to get funded the first time, and then it took us another 6 months after that to get a second round of funding, and that really slowed down our entrance into the market. We had to meter out our investments and be able to not go after the applications we saw as quickly as we wanted.
So. It seems to be a consistent theme that it just takes longer, and it's not about prototyping and manufacturing. Often in robotics, it takes longer to get funded as well. Milan, do you have a funding war story to share?
Yeah, I have the exact opposite experience, at least here at Rethink. So there's this famous, infamous joke about how to become a millionaire. You start with $1 billion. And Rethink, funding has been actually significantly easier than other startups have done, mostly because Rod Brooks has $1 billion sort of exit to his credit. And more importantly to me, 30 years of science backing up what he's trying to build. And I think sometimes I go back to how venture capital actually first started, right, where there were all these academics with so much research, and then some entrepreneurs sort of productized it type of thing. That's sort of become old-fashioned, yeah? But it's great when you can find a body of science ready to be productized that has really matured over many years. So that would be my recommendation.
Thanks, Milan. Melanie, do you have a funding war story that you can share?
I would say that one of the things that I didn't realize when we started trying to get funding is, going out and looking for funding is like looking for a husband or a wife. You're courting this person, but they have to be courting you back in some ways. You have to want to work with them because they're going to be on your board. And I think one of the things that, we haven't had too many problems lining up funding and getting term sheets and things like that. That hasn't been something that we've had a big problem with. It's actually finding someone that we really strongly feel comfortable working with. And so for us, and maybe we've been lucky, we've had the opportunity to be a little bit more picky, but it's been interesting because at first it was a little rough because we're a team of engineers and we're not very well connected to the VC culture, and it was hard to get those introduction meetings. And originally we were really in stealth and everyone's like, what's Unbounded Robotics? I mean, really? And then some of my first pitches, I sent him a slide deck with our robot in it, and like one of the first conversations I had was, did you actually build this thing, or is this like a mock-up? Are there real parts inside? And I was like, yes, there are real parts inside. And it kind of speaks to what, you know, the challenges that VCs actually have, I think, because I can only imagine the stuff that comes across their desk every day. They're probably like, oh, really? So I respect, you know, their business and what they've had to do. And I think that it's not just about like trying to get money, but it's also trying to form a partnership, because the people that give you money are going to help you. They want you to be successful. And I think that, you know, I wouldn't say it's a war story as much as, you know, it's been a growth process to try and understand, you know, what the right thing to do is, get the right introductions, and then read between the lines and find a good partner.
It must always be difficult when, as a startup entrepreneur, you've only got one or two attempts under your belt. Maybe it's your first attempt. I think it was famously said it took 10 years for Twitter to become an overnight success. And we underestimate a lot of the journey. But someone like Peter, you see a lot of startups. What do they get wrong?
Well, you know, there's a difference between raising capital and building a business. And I've found that sometimes there's overlap in skill sets, and other times people are exceptional fundraisers and, you know, completely ineffective at actually building a real company. I do think you have to understand how to play the game, and it's, you know, venture investors, we're not the devil, we are human beings, and most people respond to same cues in behavioral psychology. And so there are certain tactics that someone who's been through it before just kind of naturally, intuitively understand and use to their benefit. But for us, you know, the things that we're looking for, and, you know, in the case of several of our ventures, especially in robotics, we have backed serial entrepreneurs. That's, of course, easier to do if you see someone that you can say, I have pattern recognition, it's just that clear. You know, so in the case of Fred Moll, the founding CEO of Intuitive Surgical, who we're backing in his latest venture, or as I mentioned, Helen and Sci-Fi Works, one of the co-founders of iRobot, now doing flying robots, as she calls them, UAVs. That is evident. But some other times, it's just really a meeting that very quickly you pick up on someone who has a skill set that this person believes, they're passionate about what they're doing, they believe, they're highly effective. You can at least extrapolate forward based on what they've done that they're going to do something exceptional. But also being able to really make the judgment call that that person, if they're persuading me this quickly, and obviously there's, you know, there's the merits of the business and the opportunity and technology, but they're going to be able to attract other really great people. They're going to reduce the cost of their financing by bringing on other investors later on at higher valuations. And certainly, this is the type of entrepreneur or team that partners will flock to. So I think a lot of those things compound upon themselves, but it really starts ultimately, the genesis, from my perspective, you have to, you know, the technology, it's a given, but it's really the people. Because a lot of other ventures that we've seen, robotics and others, there is some tweak, there is some, I hate to use the word pivot, people use it so often, it's like pirouetting now, but the reality is there is an evolution, and you have to have a team that's capable, and I agree with Melanie, someone that you, there's mutual trust, that you say, this is a team that we're backing, we're gonna bet on, they're going to figure it out.
That's excellent words, Peter. John Milan, do you have anything that you see from your perspective that may be more technologically focused, although we're focusing a lot on the business of robotics startups? Anything that you see startups at the moment getting egregiously wrong?
Milan?
Egregiously wrong. I'm not sure I can credibly comment on that. I don't think smart money goes to egregiously wrong things anyway, so I think there's a shred of smartness is almost anything.
I don't know that I would say egregiously wrong, but, you know, I think that, you know, Peter commented that there's only been three robot companies over the last 20 years that got to $1 billion market valuation. You know, we'll throw Kiva in there because they got sold at $750 million. So you take those four companies, and there's one common trait between the four of them, and that was that they were focused on a market segment and robots were not their business. Robots were a vehicle to solve the application that they were focused on. You know, and I think that one of the things that companies like to do is in the robot industry is they think about the technology, and it's cool. I mean, it's great stuff. It you can attract a lot of bright people to your business or to your what you're doing because they're so excited about the technology. But at the end of the day, we're only paid, as Peter said, when we solve somebody's problem. And you know, I guess my view is that the companies, at least as I've looked at the robot industry over the last 10, 15, 20 years, the companies who have been able to succeed have had a really narrow focus on a market segment that they understood extremely well, and they were able to exploit it and be able to develop a very clear solution that that created value for those customers. You know, and in my my new role at Jabil, as I said, we're close to $20 billion in revenue. We make products all over the world. We have close to 200,000 people. We have just tremendous applications and opportunities for robots. I think Andre said that the industrial robots have kind of reached their peak, and all the opportunity is going to be in the personal robot space. I would disagree. There's a huge, huge opportunity in manufacturing, you know, and I think we've barely scratched the surface on solving these problems. I look at our factories, we're probably 10% of the applications have automation in them today, you know, so there's just a tremendous opportunity to do that. But it takes a really focused effort to solve these problems in a way that makes sense for us and makes sense for customers. So I think
Looking at these laser-focused startups, do you see any of them coming over the horizon? Is there one application that you can point to right now and say, you know, I really like what this startup's doing, or I really like this particular application. Why won't someone solve that one for us?
So I think, and this is, you know, this is partially related to robotics, but I will share the theme that, to me, is probably the most interesting thing I've seen in my career. Which is generally using robots and other systems, including satellites, as imaging capture systems. And really, that's exciting only because of what you can do with it. We've made a number of investments really across this theme, which I would call Earth imaging and analytics. I'm trying to find a better name. If anyone has any recommendations, please let me know. But really the ability to have complete contextual awareness of what's happening in the world at any time, whether that's locally, whether that's using UAVs and drones and systems to just capture and have persistent cover and being able to analyze the images, the data, the video that's coming off of that. So this company, Sci-Fi Works, it's based in Boston, basically has several different systems, robotic systems, that use this tether that allows them to transmit HD video and data as well as power, so it can basically, you know, hover for perpetuity. Now, what can you do with that? Well, there are so many different major industries that the data that they get is dated. So whether that's in heavy industry, agriculture, commodities, financial markets, traders, they're looking at data that's coming from the U.S. government or some other source. That's, you know, you're talking about economic numbers. It's from 2 months ago. Being able to collect using various capture points, again, satellite, drones, other more locally, and make use of that. Have algorithms that are running to actually create predictions and understand what's going on in the world on a minute-by-minute basis, to me, is transformative. So people think about what happened with the internet. Obviously, a lot of this will involve the internet, but I think this is just going to revolutionize many large, you know, hundreds of billions of dollars of industries and how they do business today, the intelligence they have, and also how they're able to react and how they transact.
And robots are the delivery mechanism for sensors into places where we would not otherwise easily be able
to
collect
capture
this data.
Right.
Melanie, is there a startup that you look at that you go, I love what they're doing, either because of the team or the technology or because of the market sector that they're going after?
Actually, probably 2 weeks ago, I met with the guys from AvidBots. They just came out of Accelerator, and I was actually really impressed with that company. I thought that they had a good plan. So they're doing commercial floor cleaning, and one of the things that I thought was really valuable about the business that they had put together was they found someone who was already making floor cleaning machines, and they're adding the intelligence to it. They're not trying to do what a lot of robotic companies try to do when they're going after these really specialized markets, which is, well, I want to make a floor cleaner so I can do floor cleaning. They went to the person who was really good at making floor cleaners and was like, I'd like to put some brains in that. Do you mind? And I thought that was a really solid approach to tackling that. And they actually have a Willow Garage alumni on the team. And you know, I think that they're the right sort of people. They have the right technology. They have the right background. And I think that they could, you know, really do a good job in tackling that market. And I know that that's a very specific case, but I think that there are more and more people thinking more in that light. And maybe I just criticize myself because we did go and build a robot, but no one else was building $50,000 mobile manipulators. So.
Okay, so that's one of the major points for the Uber is that comparative capabilities were much more expensive. And I know Baxter has attempted to bring capabilities down into an affordable price range, and you guys are both duking it out on which features you have and which not. But we're looking at 50K for things that were otherwise $250,000 previously. So these are now affordable for small and medium enterprises, and it really opens the door to a huge range of other applications. But as you said, Melanie, you just sort of shot yourself in the foot there, because maybe it's not about the robot. Maybe it's just about taking appliances, really boring things, and adding some level of intelligence, making them a little bit smarter, making them do a better job in the world where we already know that they're useful and desirable. Is robotics going to be transformative, or is it just going to make incremental improvements?
So just in response to shooting myself in the foot, so I guess the thing that I would say specifically about us building a full mobile manipulator is, like I said, no one else is really doing that. But in addition to that, if you really want to see advanced robotics kind of get into your home, one of the things I like to say is that you're not going to get to the moon by investing in Twitter. You're going to get to the moon by investing in SpaceX. And at some point, you have to invest in advanced robotic technology. And we happen to be a strong team that could make that technology happen and implement it for a low cost. And so I think that there's a place for very specialized things, but I also think that there's the capability for larger plays like Rethink and like our company to invest in technology that can make, you know, automation happen in these specialized markets, whether it's manufacturing or in the future, you know, elder care is a very hot topic related to robots, or even hospitality. I mean, why do you have to get room service from a person? Why can't you get it from an Uber one? So from my perspective, I think that there's an equal place in the market for those things. And it really comes down to, you know, can the team execute, and is that what they want to be doing? And we just happen to be the team that could bring that beautiful robot to life.
Now, you raised another interesting point there. I'd love to poll the panel on it. Elder care. How many of you are willing to have Uber, for example, become your robot and Frank scenario? As you grow old, are you going to have a robot companion looking after you?
Oh man, sign me up.
Milan, do you see that coming?
Yeah, we absolutely do. And our focus is really on the manipulation side. That's how we sort of see it. So if you think about elder care, mobility for the person is usually available. It's the manipulation that becomes sort of the unsolved problem when you think of, you know, the typical person that needs assistance with things, yeah? So I think tying your original question and this one together, we certainly see manipulation as a big area of innovation. That's why Rethink is focused on that particular space. You can imagine wheelchairs equipped with a manipulator type of thing, yeah? And in perfectly safe operation manners. And the emphasis, of course, will not be on that what eventually will become a very natural addition to a wheelchair, I think. The value will come from the intelligence, the behavior robotics, the software layer that the manipulator runs. And that sort of recently see that happening in the very near future, yeah.
Thanks. John, Peter, do you either have something to add about the elder care? And I should mention we're taking audience questions, so text the number on the screen.
I guess I would just add that I don't think I'm counting on my kids taking care of me, so I'm really hoping that a robot's going to be around to do that. I think that if you look demographically, you know, in 2000 there were 3.5 to 4 workers for every retiree in the United States, and you go out 30, 40 years, and there's going to be less than 2. So fundamentally, as and it's not a U.S. phenomenon, it's even worse in Asia, as we go through this aging of the population, if we don't have things like robots to do tasks, both healthcare and other, there just aren't going to be enough people around to do that, because we're all going to be old. So there's no question in my mind that some of us are older than others, that robots are going to have to play a big role in the healthcare.
Thank you.
I mean, it's interesting if you look at it just geographically. I think this fact is accurate, but I believe that senior care services, and we've been investing in the space on the healthcare side, is the fastest growing, and certainly by gross number of jobs, in the United States. So it does quickly become a jobs discussion in the United States if all of a sudden you're replacing such a large, robust industry. But I would say that I think we're going to benefit from seeing this, I would agree, first in Asia, where, you know, certainly Japan, where the culture is far more embracing of robotics generally, and given the demographic boom or bust, rather, that they're facing, you have to imagine that a lot of the test cases will be really in Asia, specifically Japan, before they even come here in the United States.
Now, this is a tricky question. I'll throw it to Melanie first. What about APIs and open hardware interfaces?
Hmm. Yeah, so our robot actually has a fully open API. We're getting very close to releasing it to the public. It doesn't get you the low-level API because that's safety-rated code. But we have an open source API that allow people to interact with the robot. It's part of our long-term vision, and I think that, I mean, Baxter has an open API that's available to the public. I think that more and more people developing robotic platforms are thinking towards integrators, are thinking towards independent developers. I mean, I would personally love if someone formed a company around an application that we haven't thought of with our robot, and so we want to enable that by having open APIs, and we also have some open parts of the hardware. We have a modularity interface on the grippers and things like that, and I think so does Baxter. So, I mean, there's a common theme there.
Yeah.
And that actually leads to one of the next questions. What about innovative business models? Melanie, you're positing that having open API will speed up the development of additional business use cases. Are there comments, Milan, on innovative business models?
Yeah, we certainly see a nice confluence, right, between the open source model and sort of the commercialization. When you go after a particular market, certainly the manufacturing industrial type of market, they're not going to run their factory on open source and, you know, Google around when there's a problem, right? They want a vendor backing it up, right? So the model where for commercial use there is a license and for the leverage, as I call it, there's the open source vehicle. I think that has really started emerging very very nicely, the freemium model, if you will. Yeah.
Peter, what would you call an innovative business model in robotics?
So this is something that I've actually given a lot of thought to, although we haven't done anything like it. But if you're a student of any industry, you generally try and look at where value is harvested and who's ultimately capturing that economic rent. And so many times you can be a technology vendor, but for whatever reason, just due to the structure of the industry, how the customers work with the vendors, your piece of the pie, you're producing no contribution margins. So you have to find where ultimately do you have the most valuable component of the food chain. And so I've actually looked at a lot of things in industrial automation, and I've thought, do you want to be a technology vendor? or do you want to be the solutions provider and integrator? And I know, you know, the panelists, some of us were discussing this earlier, but the reality is a lot of the people in industrial automation, the solutions providers go to very large manufacturers. They say, we can handle everything, we'll find the robots, but there's so many other things that you need to do, and you need us as consultants really to bring this in, and there are all these services that are added on top. And it's difficult to say what their margins are because the vast majority of these, if not all, are privately held companies. But I have to imagine that they have a very valuable business. And again, this is just pure speculation. But I've thought, is there the ability as an investor, if you almost think like a private equity investor rather than a venture investor, to take unique technology and buy one of those integrators and give them, you know, a huge technology advantage, much like how Amazon saw that Kiva acquisition. You know, Kiva could have just been a technology vendor selling robots. They created an entire system, and Amazon now is basically taking that away from the market and saying this is a competitive advantage that us, Amazon, now has against any other company that wants to compete in driving the lowest cost, most efficient warehousing. So that's kind of ill-formed. We haven't actually put it to a test and done it. But I've thought that there are creative ways that you can finance acquisitions like that where you can capture more of the market, greater margin, so that you're not just dependent upon someone else as the entry to a customer.
That's excellent. And it was a question earlier I had. Is venture capital really the best model for funding for robotics? It sounds as though private equity may at times be more effective, and we've certainly seen increasing angel investments in robotics. Do you think, what is the best funding solution for robotics?
I think it's highly dependent upon the application and the target market and the business. You know, I think private equity investors probably would not invest in a technology company, so you can do creative things, or if you have hybrid structures, perhaps you could do that. I still think the vast majority, even though there is a shrinking number of people that are investing in kind of hard innovation, there are smaller, interesting experiments happening, accelerators, which are fantastic. But for deploying larger amounts of institutional capital, and we know this because we have a lot of companies that we're backing that were constantly in the market for funding, it's a smaller herd of individuals that are still looking to take on significant technology risk, market risk, and then with the fear that they're not going to have that Twitter-like outcome where, you know, perhaps they're not actually going to create a rocket sending to the moon, but they probably made enough money that they could finance that trip or send themselves up there. So it's just challenging and something that we think about. And there's, you know, generally a number of interesting groups that are family offices, people that have built industrial conglomerates that have a personal passion. Or even, for instance, you know, a rethink investor is Bezos, Jeff Bezos, and Bezos Expeditions. So people who recognize the value perhaps have another reason why they'd want to be an investor, some other, you know, self-interest that perhaps they can bring this into their own business. But you can't, I would say, if you're relying upon traditional, and let's just cast a stone's Sandhill Road capital, I think it's going to be much more difficult than most people think.
Thanks, John.
Yeah, I think the... robots are hard. You got to have a wide set of disciplines to take a computer controlled electromechanical device that operates in real time and operates safely, and put it together and make it work reliably and consistently, and at a cost point that makes sense, and. So there's a lot of it takes a lot of investment, and you know, a lot of companies can't get past that hurdle. I think Rethink's a great example, raised $60 million. And it took how many years to get to a product?
Six
years to get to a product. I would imagine it's going to take you another 2 or 3 years to really get to a revenue stream that's going to make anyone even remotely interested. You know, it's a long, long cycle to get to a value. So, you know, I think that's a challenge, and I think that a lot of companies don't have that. A lot of investing companies don't have that staying power, especially when they can go fund an app that has a free distribution channel through Apple or Android and can be tested in the market with customers without any hardware, without having to make really much of an investment. You know, one thing that that I think about as I think about the industrial robot market, and one of the, I think, inflection points that we're going to see is that with these collaborative robots that Rethink is working on and that Melanie's team is working on, it offers the opportunity to reimagine the integration channel to market. So today, the dominant companies who build solutions around robots are big metal bending, capital intensive companies, because to deploy a traditional robot, you gotta put it on a big table, you gotta build a big safety fence around it, you gotta build a lot of hardware just to get it to a point of readiness to actually then do application and a process. So, you know, if you can eliminate all that, you can take the robot we saw over there and have it ready to go and simply focus on the application. You know, I think what it does is it allows that old model of integration to get replaced by companies that look more like IT companies, IT integration companies, who are focused just on solving the application process and really aren't saddled with a bunch of hardware and capital to be able to do it. So I think there's a real opportunity that comes about as you get to these safe robots and as they make it to market.
Well, that really answered one of the other questions as well, which is...
I saw it on your thing.
You did. I don't know how. You had a robot for that. That was, will it be 30 years before the general purpose, before a viable robot market, shall we say. But speaking of a viable robot market, here's a very specific question. Intel recently introduced Jimmy, an open source personal robot. Will Jimmy-like robots become the next smartphones? Melanie.
I was just talking about this last night. I think it depends on what you want Jimmy to do. Right now, Jimmy doesn't have grippers. So if you want Jimmy to do anything in your house, you're pretty much SOL. So that's not awesome. I think that you know, when we envision robots that we want to have, they do something for us. They provide value to our lives. And I think that Jimmy is a good point in the right direction, but Jimmy also costs $16,000. I mean, you're a third of the way to our robot, and Jimmy's like this tall and has no hands. So, but I think that
stop picking on Jimmy.
I like Jimmy. No, yeah. I like Jimmy because there are some things. I mean, it depends on what you want, what value you're trying to provide, and Jimmy's an interesting platform because it lowers the cost and the barrier entry for people working on walking robots. That's not a tack that our company's trying to take because from our perspective, it's not something you should worry about. There's plenty of people in the world that don't have legs, that are in wheelchairs, that are missing arms, that don't have hands, that can do things in their daily lives. And the United States has done stuff to accommodate that. It's called the American with Disabilities Act. And if you build robots to those standards, then you don't need legs. And you can get around and do things like that. But I think Jimmy has a place in terms of robotics development, but I don't know if it's the iPhone of personal robotics. Because I think that the biggest problem in getting robots into our home is what value do they provide to us. And you know, one of the quotes that I remember from Scott, who started Willow Garage, he said he went on this really big tour of all of these automation facilities in Asia, and he saw that they could produce 8 cars in like an hour, you know. 8 cars an hour, you know. But then he comes home and his laundry won't go from the washer to the dryer. And he's like, why can't we bring that automation into our home? And it's that kind of value that we're looking for. And unfortunately, although Jimmy is a really cool robot, he's not going to move the laundry from the washer to the dryer. And I think that's the value people are looking for, especially when the technology costs as much as a car.
Absolutely. Now, everyone else can weigh in on Jimmy. He's down, so you can come back to that. But Melanie, you did raise a point that relates to one of the next questions, and that's the role that standards play, both in enabling and obstructing the development of robotics. And literally, can we discuss some of the changes that need to happen for success in robotics, i.e. the FAA rules on UAVs or liability for autonomous vehicles, or perhaps the issue of insurance or liability for domestic or other robots? Milan, I'll throw that to you.
So from our perspective, where we are focused on is I'll answer a couple of the questions. In terms of investment, why does it take so much money to do a robotics investment versus the application, the app, the next app type of thing? Well, that's because you got to start from scratch. You got to build your whole platform again. There is no standard, scalable hardware platform. So everybody's, it's sort of like, you had IBM, and then with a lot of luck, you had Amdahl, because you had to do everything from scratch. You fast forward to sort of how the PC industry, the hardware platform is somewhat standard, scalable but standard, and then allows the innovation to happen at the application level. So we think that the biggest change that needs to really happen, or where we're driving towards, is the availability of a scalable hardware platform that is human safe, that is mobile. Rod sometimes calls it, the three problems in robotics, mobility, manipulation, and messiness. So if there's a standard way of dealing with those three basics, then I think that's going to really spawn a whole new generation, new era of innovation on top of these standard platforms. So I think if you see some of the technology in Baxter from Rethink, or some of the mobile platforms, you'll start seeing that these things are actually scalable and can become a standard, so that you're no longer trying to invent the actual physical hardware. You can invent the application on top of that. So I think that's what's needed. Mm.
And Peter, you will have run into standards being an issue with both the medical robotics that you've invested in and the UAVs. So it would seem a lot slower, although robotics in the health sector is definitely a growing field. There are so many more hurdles that have to be overcome. And in the US, the FAA is placing many hurdles in front of commercial operation of UAVs, but they've just allowed the go-ahead for limited commercial operations for drones that are doing special purpose tasks like power line inspection, which would seem to fit in with Sci-Fi Works' direction.
Yeah, so you're absolutely right. Regulation is, for us, just goes with the territory. I will say that I guess dealing with the FAA is probably something that I probably wouldn't have never thought I would have been dealing with. But, certainly on the surgical robotics side, the FDA is something that we're familiar with more from the biotech and med device side. It's a natural, unfortunately, dealing with regulated industries, that's just what you get involved with. And you have people that are dealing with it extraordinarily aggressively in the IT side for the first time, like an Uber, who has to deal with all of this red tape that exists, whether it's federal standards or obviously local municipalities, unions, et cetera. For us, on the FAA side, it's interesting. There are a number of various experiments that they're running. They have several sites as well that you're legally allowed to fly. I think there's six sites that the FAA has opened up. And it just so happens, and I cannot claim that it's any wisdom on our part or genius, but the fact that Sci-Fi Works has a tether, for whatever reason, there's some lobbyist in DC that was not operating on behalf that we owe a steak dinner to, but they are exempted from those FAA guidelines. So, Merry Christmas, I guess. Wow. But
tie your robots down.
Yes.
But it is fairly complex, and the reality is, even as investors, we're forced to understand what's going on in DC and have greater insight than you would that if you're just building an internet company or a software company. Again, another layer of complexity that frankly, as an investor, if you understand the process, you can gain insight and an advantage. But certainly creates obstacles and headwinds.
Thank you. And a question for John is, do you see a general purpose robotic platform like Unbounded or Baxter being able to solve your laser focus type of applications? Or will you still need customized and thus more expensive robots?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think we're a big proponent of these collaborative robots. I think because if you look at our problem, our problem is the product lives that we deal with in some cases are a year or two. And in fact, amazingly, I didn't never do this, but in some cases, companies launch products just for Christmas, 3-month product lives, and then they pull them off the shelves after that. It's remarkable. So the fundamental problem that companies in the manufacturing space have is that if you've got really short product lives, you can't, and you've got aggressive ramps, you can't automate that and get an ROI on it fast enough before it's gone and you got to throw all the stuff away. So what's really critical for companies like mine to solve our problems is to have robotic platforms that can move across product families and can go from one product life to the next. So, you know, at that level, absolutely. You know, I think the challenge is that today's collaborative robots, for the most part, don't have a performance characteristic that would really present an ROI for most of the applications we see. You know, so, you know, one of the things is there's this trade-off. If you want to get production, you got to go buy an industrial robot. If you want to get safety, you can buy a collaborative one, but you're not going to get productivity. And so, you know, if you look at our company, 99.8% of the robots we have installed are all industrial robots because we can't get to a level of capability in the collaborative ones yet to do it. But over time, as they become better, that's the holy grail. So
the next question relates to that time range. If the audience was starting their robot company, aiming to produce something that was going to meet your unmet need at the moment for robots, tomorrow would be good from your perspective. But how much funding is needed from idea to final result for a reasonable robotics startup?
My experience, bare minimum, tens of millions of dollars. So you have to understand that going in, and there, you know, the way that the venture model works, for those that are not familiar, that's tranched really by various developments. So that can start out as $1 million to get you to some milestone, and then it's $10 million or, you know, $8 million in a Series A. Whatever it is, it's based upon milestones and kind of not drip feeding in particular, but certainly something where all the capital does not come up front. But I find it highly unlikely, even with benevolent government funding or grant funding or other private individuals or customer funding, that I think it's really difficult to build at scale something that is a material business, a large scale enterprise, without that type of capital.
Thanks. Leaping ahead, because there's not a lot of time left and there's a lot of questions covering a huge range of things. Melanie, what programming languages lend themselves best to robot development?
That really depends what kind of development you're trying to do. The two main languages that we use on the robot are C++ and Python. Basically, you want a hard compiled language to do anything that is computationally efficient. And of course, we have embedded processes in our robot, so the control is obviously done in C or C++. But when you're trying to do quick development, you end up turning more and more to Python to prototype, because it's very quick. You can be sloppy and then eventually turn that into nice C or C++ when you're done. So it's a mix. But you know, given that we have, you know, ROS APIs for the robot, there's many supported language APIs that you could use with our robot, from Java to Lisp to, I don't know what other language you might want to use, Pascal or something ridiculous like that. But those language APIs are supported in ROS, and so you're not really tied to a specific language. But as you get further and further into application development, you typically want to be in a compiled language that's computationally efficient, because you are process limited on an onboard computer, especially in a mobile robot. Less so with a robot that doesn't have an onboard computer, but and there's still things like, people talk about the cloud, and you can't have your navigation software in the cloud, because by the time it goes to the cloud and back, you've already hit someone. So those are things that, you know, yeah, the cloud is beautiful, but the cloud is not always meant for everything on robots.
So Milan, I'll throw this one to you, but everybody chime in really quickly. How would you prepare the next generation of entrepreneurs for robotics?
Yes.
The kids in the audience.
Definitely. So a couple of things. Again, I think within the kids' generation, there will be a standard or set of standard hardware platforms, and all the innovation will move to the software application behavior level. So classic, you know, programming backgrounds and so on. That is what I think the whole industry is shifting towards, yeah.
Just solve my problems. I'll be happy.
This happens to be a topic that's very close to my heart, and I actually am glad that you raised this. So first, great to see children in the audience. One of my partners, Larry Bach, has often said to us, you get what you celebrate, especially in a culture here in America. And what he says is, you know, when you celebrate celebrity in athletics, then you have a nation of young people who are growing up wanting to emulate Kim Kardashian or LeBron James. And, you know, nothing against them, but the reality is we believe deeply that you want to create, and hold up great scientists and engineers in this country. And so I think actually, you know, something that we didn't talk about, but I think is an important topic is, a lot of the acquisitions made by companies like Google and others. And I think that while great for the individual entrepreneurs who are now allowed a platform, they don't feel the need or they don't have the need to go out and fundraise, unfortunately that withdraws from a lot of really bright people who are getting started in their career, the ability to have those iconic figures that inspire them to move forward. So imagine if you know, Elon Musk had decided early on in his career, or at least with Tesla, to sell for $50 million to Nissan. Tesla in its current iteration would not exist. People would not know of Elon Musk in the way that they do, or if he had sold SpaceX to some other government contractor. So I think, you know, the robotic space, things that can happen that whether, you know, it's any of us on this panel or in the room, the ability to have that kind of precedent, someone that breaks a mold, that is that iconic figure, that Rod Brooks, or, you know, insert X or Y name there, I think that will really inspire people to create iconic companies that last, that are public companies. So when you have a lot of acqui-hires or acquisitions, most of the individuals that started Boston Dynamics or insert any of the other 8 companies that were acquired by Google recently, you're probably not going to remember. You're not going to hear much from them. You may see, hopefully, something amazing from Google that inspires people. But I do think that a lot of young people starting out are inspired, whether by Bill Gates or by Sergey and Larry or Mark Zuckerberg. And so I think that is absolutely needed in this space to show that you can create a great, iconic, lasting company, not just something that's acquired for an undisclosed amount and then folded into a giant.
So we certainly have a lot to thank iRobot, all of the founders from iRobot, for waving that flag. And indeed, John, Adept was one of the largest American robotics companies, significant things there. And I was thinking when you said we need great robotics role models, well, Curiosity, the Mars rovers, there were fantastic moments there that really ignited interest and wonder and all of the terror of the 7-minute descent and the knowledge that we're treading on new worlds via robots. And I think I see that in my own children. That's one of the things that's inspiring them. But I'll also say that robotics competitions, and there's a huge range of them, just about everyone I know in robotics has shared some time as a mentor, as a participant, as a judge, in some way getting involved with the robotics competitions that are fantastic STEM activity and inspire entrepreneurship as well as engineering.
Yeah, I was going to say that, you know, one of the great things about robots for kids is that it's a way to turn math and science into something fun, you know. Now, what's great about creating an app, you know, it just kind of makes your computer screen move around. But, you know, the having a robot, programming something and having it do a task is much more enriching and really captures your imagination. And really, you know, the future of the United States is all built on math and science. You know, our ability to create the next generation of engineers and scientists and mathematicians is really what's going to create the next levels of technology for us. And robots are a wonderful way to get kids at a young age to embrace the technology and be excited about it. So it does a lot of good.
So that's really the magic of robotics, is that it's embodying all of the science, technology, engineering, and math that we do so well and so desperately need. And it comes to life for us when in robot form.
Yeah, I would say another thing is when you said getting young entrepreneurs and kids involved, all I was thinking is I am a kid, because when you look at many of the giants in robotics today, they were just starting to become giants when I was born. And in robotics, it's a long haul. You don't graduate with your BS and suddenly you're this magical roboticist. It's a very in-depth career path. And you have to be really committed to robotics, and that maybe that's good that we're creating all these robotics competitions, because we're creating the zealousness that we need to keep the path of robotics, because it's a challenging career. You need to have a lot of engineering knowledge. You have to have a lot of deep background and domain knowledge that isn't trivial. And actually, one of the things that I did during my time at Willow is trying to lower the bar to entry to robotics by creating the TurtleBot. Because one of the biggest challenges with getting involved in robotics is having a robot that's sophisticated enough, but accessible enough to do interesting things with. And I think that the pairing of something like FIRST with the capabilities of something like TurtleBot that get people involved in programming robots, which is where the real challenges are.
That's an excellent point. And the last 30 seconds each, is there advice for entrepreneurs in robotics that you can put as neatly as Melanie just did?
Get started. I think the time is ripe.
Yeah. Don't give up.
I mean, I agree. Action and persistence. So don't just think about it. Do and keep doing. And you know, it's never just a smooth process, but it's worth it in the end.
Yeah. Thank you very much.